Okay, we're going to be doing some orthopedic special tests, and we don't diagnose in massage therapy. We assess special tests. If you look at the research on them, they're not the best for diagnosing, and we don't do that, so it's not a problem for us. What they are pretty good at is identifying tissue lesions by compressing or shearing forces of the tissue. So a special test is used to identify a particular tissue that may be a problem. So they're pretty good at that, but they're not very good at being very specific about what that tissue might be. It could be a variety of things. So, you know, with a diagnostic, basically, or a diagnosis is saying that's what it is. Well, special tests aren't the greatest for that, but they will identify problems in the area many times. So we use them as a rule in massage therapy, and they're an important part of the evaluation process. So I'm going to be talking about some of the tests that I like, the go-to tests that I use, some of the things I've found over the years related to special tests and different common orthopedic conditions at each joint. So why don't we start off with doing the cervical spine frameal compression tests and talk about these. Primarily they're used to identify in the cervical spine problems with disc prolapse or bone spurs, the spondylolisthesis, spondylitis. As well, they're often very good to identify facet joint problems. So if the person is exhibiting sharpshooting pain down the arm or into the hand, tingling, numbness, paresthesia, you might consider there might be a nerve problem. And they do help to identify if it is a nerve problem related to a nerve root problem. And if it isn't a nerve root problem, but you are getting generalized pain from the neck into the shoulder, it may be facet joint irritation. So they will help to identify those things. So we'll start with Spurlings. Spurlings is a classic foraminal compression test that narrows the foraminal space. And so I'm just going to step behind Megan here. Now you can do it two ways. You can stand behind the person or you can stand beside them and do it. If you want to see their expression on their face and stay in contact with them, you can stand beside them and do it, but I'm going to stand behind her. So what you want to do is you want to laterally, so if she's getting sharp shooting pain going down this arm, I take her to the opposite side first, clear this side, so you do a lateral flexion, and then you want to push straight down in a straight line, compressing and seeing if there's any discomfort. Is that okay there?
Yep.
Okay, we're going to do a distraction, a cervical spine distraction. If she has sharp shooting pain going down her right arm, this would theoretically diminish it or relieve the discomfort in the cervical spine and may diminish some of the sharp shooting pain. And again, that would be for a space occupying lesion. Okay, just going to grasp here, grasping behind the occipital area, just underneath the jaw, and lift up. See a little bit of movement lifting up. Okay, we're going to be doing the upper limb tensioning test. These are, if the person's having numbness, tingling, sharp shooting pain in one or two fingers, or if they're having numbness and tingling in many of the fingers or most of the hand, these are somewhat my go-to special tests. They're pretty good at finding out if there's a neurological problem, whether it's coming from the cervical spine or a brachial plexus problem. So they're quite helpful in finding out if there's some neurological radicular pain conditions. So if the person had a nerve root lesion, you could do an upper limb tensioning test because it pulls on the nerve, and when the nerve is pulled upon, when it's compressed, it's not very happy. Or if you had brachial plexus issues in through here, compression by the scalenes, the first rib, and the clavicle, or pec minor. These tests are pretty good at identifying nerve problems. And mostly it's the recreation of the person's symptoms while doing these. Now, people that have had concussions will often be test very strongly to nerve tensioning. And it has to do with the dura mater. When you pull on the nerve, the dura mater seems to be more resistant with people that have concussions. Now, I found that. I don't know if that's in the literature or not, but But in clinical practice here at Algonquin, I've noted a number of people that when you do upper limb tension tests and they've had concussions, they seem to test much more strongly for limited movement of the peripheral nerves. So let's do upper limb tension test one. So what I want to do, I want to bring the shoulder up to about 110 degrees. And depending on the size, depending on your size and the person's size, you may alter the way you do these tests. But I'm going to show you how I do them. Now, they recommend that she'll laterally flex her head at the end. I may put her head on that side first. If it's a client that doesn't take instructions well, you may want to position the head laterally before you do this. Because at the end of the test, I would want the person to laterally flex their head to the opposite side. They do it really quickly. It can really cause discomfort with the testing. So I'm going to just laterally flex your head over here, right there to start with. I'm going to bring the arm up to 110 degrees. I'm going to take my right hand, I'm going to place it on top of the shoulder, and I'm going to push down, I'm going to compress it down like this so the shoulder's compressed down. And I'm going to take this hand, and I'm going to externally rotate. You're comfortable there?
Yep.
I'm going to turn the wrist in this direction. I'm feeling a little bit of tension there. What you'll sometimes notice is you'll feel on the right hand here, you'll feel the shoulder pull up when you start pulling the nerve. Okay there?
Yep.
We're going to do the ULTT2, which also tests the median nerve. I'm going to have Megan laterally flex her head at the end.
No.
That's okay. Just at the end of the test. So again, there's many ways of doing this. I'm going to apply my my shoulder into her shoulder here, or at the elbow. I'm going to take my elbow and get it underneath the elbow, underneath her shoulder. I'm going to bring her hand out in this position, and I'm just going to push down like this. So I'm depressing the shoulder itself, and then I'm going to bring the arm out like this. Is that comfortable there?
Yep.
Now, could you just slowly laterally flex your head there? That's good. I can feel it pulling right there. Good. Okay, so again, same position here. I've got my bicep into the top of her shoulder, and I'm going to depress the shoulder like this. And I'm going to immediately rotate the humerus and the forearm. Immediately rotate, this is for the radial nerve, the ULTT3, and depress the shoulder, immediately rotate, and flex the wrist, and just laterally flex your head a little bit. Good? You feel it pulling there at all?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and that should be going into the back of the thumb and the posterior side of the thumb and hand, if it's the radial nerve, okay? Okay, we're going to do ULTT4 of the ulnar nerve. So this is a little trickier. I'm going to bring Megan's wrist up like this. I'm going to take my left hand and let her arm rest on my forearm. And I've got her wrist extended, her fingers flared a little bit. I'm going to come up here, depress the shoulder down, hold that, and I'm going to bring... You okay so far?
Yep.
I'm going to bring the fingers up towards the ear and make sure that I'm depressing the shoulder. Now you can just slowly laterally flex a little bit. Oh, stop. I can feel a real strong pull there. Okay, and that's good. Okay, we're going to do shoulder depression and the shoulder abduction test. They're somewhat similar to the upper limb tensioning test in a way where we're stretching this side and we're compressing this side. So on this side, we're going to, if they have pain on this side, it's more related to most likely facet joint irritation. If the person's having sharp shooting pain going down this arm, if they, on this side, it's more likely facet. On this side, it reproduces the symptoms the person's been having. It's more likely neuro-related. So it's simply laterally flexing the head in this direction and compressing the shoulder. You can see and through how it stretches. So similar to the upper limb tensioning test, between the nerve roots and the clavicle and the pec and the scalenes, I'm doing a nice long stretch here. If the person reacts to that, reproduces the pain down the shoulder and down in the hand, it's probably neuro-related. Though on the opposite side, if it becomes uncomfortable, it's highly probable it's facet joint problems, and if there's no sharp shooting pain down the arm. Now, the abduction test is simply bringing the arm up and putting it on top of the head. Now, a person with a nerve entrapment, an irritation, when you take the pressure off a nerve or you put slack into the nerve, often the discomfort will diminish. So this often will diminish the sharp shooting pain or diminish the pain the person's been having if it's a neural problem related to the nerve root. And the other way, of course, this will increase by stretching the nerve. We're going to do the intervertebral artery test for the intervertebral artery. And how we do that, we're going to have Megan come off the table. So she brings her head right off the table here. Great. And I'm going to rotate her head, and then I'm going to extend it in the rotated position. And if she's having symptoms with the intervertebral artery, she'll have rapid eye movement, nystagmus, or she'll have dizziness, lightheadedness. Okay? That compresses the intervertebral artery. Okay.